Swear not being there.
introduce the lovely Jamie as well, who is not from our choir project, he's from the music band project that gets run at Youth Theatre as well. So, Jamie. Just to tell you a little bit about me and my colleagues as well, once we graduated being members of the Youth Theatre as well, we also formed with our tutor at the time, Tracy, a jazz four-piece vocal harmony group called The Night and Days as well, which, without shamelessly plugging us, we're available for bookings. Weddings, birthdays, bar mitzvahs, anything. So next up is the lovely Georgia, and this is a song that she's wrote herself as well, and we've done some backing vocals, because we like to develop a group to create their own music as well, as covering other vocals as well, so take it away, Georgia.
What do I do? thank you for civics around that. That's no problem.
Overwhelmed with over 200 responses to that tea dance.
sponsoring, some people sponsoring over four tickets. One of them I remember saying, I want to sponsor four tickets in memory of my mother. I thought that was an absolutely wonderful thing to do. And it sparked off a thought in my mind. And that was, there is no giving page, just giving page, on the website for the mayoral charities. It does two things. One, if there was a page on the council website for just giving, it gives the opportunity for members of the public, things like dress down days in schools and so forth, to donate to the mayor's charities. Also, it gives the mayor the opportunity to thank those people, like I've just done now with the staff. A lot of the staff won't come to council tonight, but I would still like that message to get out to thank them. And so I do wish that thought could be given to starting up a web page for the mayor's charity Just Giving. Having said those two things, that's all I've got on the mayor's announcements. So moving on to petitions, item three on the agenda, there are petitions which councillors wish to present to the council in accordance with Standing Orders 21. Councillor.
Thank you.
and Joan is the cabinet member for this particular question to be addressed to.
Councillors the same council have said they're not playing any ball because they've done something wrong. I think it's absolutely scandalous. I'm absolutely shocked that a member of the public has come in and made that pass across everybody as though we're all tarred with a brush, that we've all done something illegal. My expense in the Office of Public Scrutiny, any time they want, I look on the council website, you'll see nil against me.
Thank you, Councillor Abbey. Can I take your seat here? Perhaps Councillor Adrian Jones to respond to that question.
I assume the question is not going to be pertinent to that, but in any case, it would be a no return. Officers are working very hard, collecting all the taxi and mileage claims of members, and they'll be publishing that information in the coming months. However, a summary details listing payments made to each individual member for expenses claims relating to the 2014-15 financial year have been available on the council website for some time. In 2014-15, the council paid directly to the taxi company approximately £3,800 of taxi costs in respect of elected members. The taxi costs incurred directly and the additional reclaimed taxi fares, expenses by members, that is a not £3,800, are included within the members' allowances information available to the public on our website. I'm advised that during the inspection of accounts process this year, you asked to inspect over 7,000 separate invoices, a number of contracts, and have asked to inspect all member expenses and invoices for taxes. This is a considerable volume of information being requested from one person, and it inevitably takes time to collate, and prepare such information, as all personal information, commercially sensitive, bank account details, and other sensitive information must be removed. The council is committed to being open and transparent, and deals with many requests for information through various avenues. I'm sure you know that guidance from the National Audit Office provides that members of the public wishing to inspect accounts must always act reasonably. The guidance also states that ultimately it is the local taxpayers in the community that pay most of the costs of questions and objections through their council tax. I've been advised that you have received approximately 1,500 pages of information. This has involved several hundred hours of our officers' time being extended to collate and repair the information. And the cost of this work is estimated to be in excess of £10,000, which will inevitably increase as we continue to meet follow-up inquiries. Your reference to savings on members' expenses is noted, and of course we welcome any savings that are and can be made. But I think we should also have regard to the direct and the associated costs that have been incurred in achieving that saving.
Yeah.
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 Have to get out of this chair. on to minutes of this council. Turn to item 5, the minutes of this council meeting held on the 12th and the 19th, 2015, are contained within pages 1 to 30. I will move approval of these two sets of minutes as a correct record. Do I have a proposer? Oh,
can I ask in respect to the minutes for 12 October Council, that minute 31 would be amended to include my definition of interest, and then also if they're interested for them in the agenda, in item 11, strict for looking at the rules.
Was this pointed out on the, night? You did, okay. With those amendments, do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Are there any other issues with respect to these minutes? All those in favour, please clearly indicate. All those against? Any abstentions? Moving on to item 6, leaders, executive members and chairs reports. Item 6 on page 31 to 70 of the agenda contains the reports of the leaders, cabinet members and policy and performance committee chairs. The council is invited to receive and note these reports. Cabinet portfolio holders will not present their reports, which will be taken as read. All questions must be confined to the contents of the reports. Questioners, please ensure that your question is no longer more than 2 minutes. The total number of questions on any one report will not normally exceed more than 5 minutes. Responses to questions will be reserved to the conclusion of all questions on a particular report. Cabinet members, please ensure your responses do not exceed 10 minutes. Councillor Green.
Thank you, Mr. Baird. I could ask the leader of the council on his summary report. Under item 1, we talk about the work being underway to develop a 5-year budget strategy. We've seen the first musings of this strategy that came out of the cabinet report, the report on finances that's going to cabinet. And I wonder whether the leader would answer a couple of points. First of all, why is the proposal included to avoid calling or for calling to be waived? Surely if we sequence the meetings properly, then if those proposed could have been discussed by cabinet and then discussed here. Would the leader agree with me that if, as seems to be proposed within the document, that the actual amount being spent on adult care is going to be cash limited to the same level it is at the moment, 77 million, whereabouts, that any use of the 2% that the Chancellor has said in order to support adult social care would really just be masquerading as a 4% council tax increase without those extra resources going in to adult social care. And finally, Mr. Mayor, would the leader agree with me that now he's stepping down from the chairmanship of the combined authority, which of course I congratulate him on the work that he did there, but now that he's stepping down, would it not be an opportunity to save the £49,000 from the consultant that he took on, because he was in fact the chair of the combined authority? And is that a saving that will make its way into the cabinet meeting next week?
By Councillor Davis to respond.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor. in terms of the question around calling being made, my understanding is that all of the budget options which are going out to consultation will be scrutinised in January by all of the scrutiny committees. So it seems to me that there will be ample opportunity for all members to look at all of the options, come up with alternatives, additional ideas, before it comes back to cabinet at the end of February. And I think that's in line with the way that we have done these exercises in previous years. So I don't think it's going to detract in any way from proper scrutiny of all of these proposals. Secondly, in the case of the adult social care 2% precept, I mean, I'm pretty clear that in the Chancellor's rules and statements, the 2% precept will have to be spent on adult social care, elderly care services. But can I just use this opportunity to say how much I deplore that mechanism that George Osborne announced as a way of properly funding, well, not properly funding actually, or rightly informing elderly care services. We know for a fact that the King's Fund have done a study to show that the 2% precept, which I think is more accurately should be referred to as a grey tax, will generate around £800 million across England. When we know, just to meet the basic needs of our elderly people, we need £2 billion. So there will be a massive shortfall in this. And of course, we know that in Wirral, we would need, the information I've got from the director is that we would need to increase our adult social care budget by 8.4 million just to meet our basic need. A 2% precept will generate about 2.2 million. So there'll be a huge gap compared to the need that we have. And of course, it's a double whammy in Wirral, because not only have we got an above average population in terms of our elderly population, but of course we've got a low council tax base. So a 2% council tax rise won't raise anywhere near as much money as wealthy southern councils. And this is another example of the fundamental unfairness about the way this government goes about funding public services. And, you know, I think this is the first example in my lifetime of a really important service which should be funded, I believe, by national governments. And they're passing the buck to local people to pay for it. So my challenge back to him is this the way forward now? Pay as you go services from governments. What will be next? Children's services. What will be next? Leisure. And it is an absolute abrogation of duty for the Chancellor to pass the burden on to local council taxpayers in Wirral to what should be a properly funded pot of money by a national government in Whitehall. And I think it's outrageous. And on the issue of the combined authority, yes, I am having negotiated the Sydney Region deal. I've decided that I need to focus my time as leader of Wirral. I will still be, although playing full part, representing Wirral on the combined authority and the cabinet of leaders. But the pretty, frankly, pathetic comments he makes about the member of staff concerned. I don't know if he knows, but clearly, that member of staff has been employed not on exclusively city region issues. He's been employed to help us deliver our 2020 plan, which I thought the whole council was signed up to. At least we all voted for it. The administration loves this council, Jeff. You're not leaving the council anymore. So, frankly, Mr. Mayor, if that's the best that Jeff can do in terms of an alternative proposal to what the priorities we're putting forward to this council, I think it's a pretty shabby and a pretty pitiful performance, isn't there? Thank you very much.
The council now in the invited note that we report. Now moving on to the cabinet portfolio report on transformation and improvement. Are there any questions to Councillor Amber Lockwood? Councillor.
22 of your report out. Do you mind, Council, please, what the transformation programme is?